Hi, I'm Kelly Cervantes, and this is Seizing Life, a weekly podcast produced by Citizens United for Research in Epilepsy. Cure. Today, Dr. Takijah Heard joins us from the Northshore Neurological Institute. She is the Division Head of Pediatric Neurology and Epilepsy, where she treats a wide range of neurological conditions and specializes in epilepsy. In this episode, Dr. Heard shares how she uses the vagal nerve stimulator, more commonly known as VNS.
Dr. Heard, thank you so much for coming to chat with us today.
Thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
So tell us a little bit about yourself. We got a little bit of your bio from that intro, but what made you decide to go into epilepsy?
So going into medicine was something that I sort of always sort of thought about ever since I was young. My mom was sick growing up, and I saw how doctors sort of influenced our life whenever it made my mom feel better. The whole house felt better. But then I ended up being born here in Chicago, grew up in Texas, but came back for medical school. So I went to University of Chicago for medical school. Between your first and second year of medical school, you have to do a research project. And so I felt like I had seen other things, but I had never seen a seizure. And whenever I got into my clinicals, which is the third and fourth year, I wanted to make sure that I had seen a seizure before. And so I did my research in epilepsy. It was in a lab with Dr. Marcoselli. He happened to be my role model and the whole reason that I happened to be an epileptologist.
Well, we're a little partial to him in our family
as well.
He's my daughter's doctor. So you're here to talk to us today about vagal nerve stimulators, the VNS therapy, as a treatment for seizures. Can you explain the device to us and how it works?
So the vagal nerve stimulator happens to be a non-invasive sort of procedure that can be done as an outpatient. It's a non-open brain surgery. It happens to have a coil that sort of wraps around the vagus nerve, and they have a generator they sort of place on the left side in the, like, maybe a couple of inches below the clavicle.
Okay, and so you have you brought some of them here today. So the device goes just underneath the skin, and then there are wires that come up and connect to the vagus nerve,
which happens to be in the neck. Yes.
Okay, and why does it work?
So it ends up targeting the vagus nerves. The vagus nerves then sort of connects to the brain and sort of sends amounts of energy that happens to be treatment amounts of energy to sort of combat the seizure, which is an additional aberrant amount of energy to sort of stop the seizures.
And how does it know when to work?
And so it has great configurations in which it sort of has a time frame at which it comes on, and then it has a time frame at which it gives the amount of energy. So it can be, you know, 30 seconds, it could be up to a minute. And then we go up on the amount of energy in milliamps until we get to a therapeutic amount. Therapeutic is usually about 1.5 milliamps. And then that's whenever we start to notice that as it cycles every 5 minutes, that you'll start to notice that the seizure frequency will start to go down.
Ah, I see. So it is triggering the vagus nerve at, you know, at whatever, every 5 minutes, or I'm sure whatever you set that to be at.
Yep.
Now, is it the kind of thing where if someone feels a seizure coming on that they can trigger it to try and stop the seizure?
Great question. So they have a device, it's called a magnet. It looks very similar to an Apple Watch. So it's a large device that that you can put on like an Apple Watch, or you can wear it around your neck.
Okay.
And you can trigger it by swiping it. So I usually will say, you know, put a W across the actual stimulator that activates it, sending an extra jolt of energy that's usually about 0.5 milliamps larger than the normal routine amount.
Okay. And then how in the world did they figure out that this worked? Do you have any idea?
No, not really. But we definitely noticed that the vagus nerve is one of the cranial nerves.
Okay.
And so this is one of the ones that happens to come, you know, out of the brain and we have easy access to. So is there a way in which we can sort of get to the brain without it actually being a open brain surgery?
So this device isn't in the brain, but correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe I've seen similar devices that can be placed on the brain. What is the difference between those two?
Okay, so the other device that can be placed in the brain that you leave and you sort of live with is something called NeuroPace.
Okay.
It's a responsive device that you actually place in the brain. It's a brain surgery that sort of lies within the skull itself.
Okay, so two completely different devices.
Correct.
How is the VNS powered?
So it has a battery. The battery life can last anywhere from 5 to 10 years. Usually about 7 to 8 years is usually the battery life for most. Obviously, it could be shorter if we're sort of doing the times in which the cycling happens much more frequently than 5 minutes, and can last up to 10 years.
And so what happens when the battery runs out? Because this is under your skin. It's not like, you know, the remote control where you can just pop new batteries in. This is a little more invasive.
Well, not so much. So there is going to be, you know, the vagal nerve stimulator generator is going to be under the skin. And so they make a small incision where it's at. It's sort of placed in a pocket. They remove the generator from out of that pocket and slide in a new generator. So again, it's a daytime procedure, so it's not anything you have to be in the hospital for. You get it done, you put in a new battery, then you get to go home.
Oh, wow. And so is the, how long does that procedure take, both, you know, that initial procedure and then, you know, switching the generator out?
Yeah. So it usually is a daytime procedure. So, you know, maybe a couple of hours that you may be there. You'll leave the hospital at that time, and then you'll return to see an epileptologist like myself. We'll turn it on and start to get you up to the appropriate therapeutic dose of the energy every 2 weeks.
And how long typically does that process take to get from, you know, the device's place to therapeutic? Because I know, you know, with prescription drugs, it can take, you know, weeks or months with some of these drugs to get up to a fully therapeutic level. So it's not, you know, you just
right.
get going. What is that process like with this device?
So you'll get the surgery, you'll leave. 2 weeks later, you'll come to the office, and then we'll sort of give you a subtherapeutic dose, but a dose that sort of allows your body to get used to this now new energy that's going to happen every 5 minutes. So about maybe 4 to 6 weeks, you should be at a therapeutic dose. Obviously, it could be that it takes a little bit longer if you have any side effects. Some of the side effects include like hoarseness of your voice, because it's not far from the nerve that sort of deals with the voice. Cough. Some people complain of shortness of breath, and then sometimes people will sort of feel like a humming or the change in the character of their voice.
And are there, my next question was going to be the side effects, because I hear you saying the word dose the exact same way that we would talk about a pharmaceutical med.
Exactly.
And we all know that the pharmaceutical meds come with their fun array of side effects. Are there any other more severe side effects, or, you know, scratchy voice and a cough? I mean, can it get to the point where it's so uncomfortable that someone might have it removed? What have you seen in your experience?
Yeah, not too often that I see somebody actually has it removed. Some people will find that they find the hoarseness to be too much for them, or the cough or the tickle in their throat to sort of be something that's a little bit annoying. Usually we'll go back down on the dose, sort of allow them to get used to that, and then try to go up again.
Okay. Who is a good candidate to try the VNS therapy?
So the great thing is that it's been FDA approved for kids that are 4 and older. It's happily done for kids that have intractable epilepsy. So kids that have already been on a couple of medications, usually they're sort of better to be sort of started on the VNS. It's something that you sort of add to their treatment of their medications, and oftentimes you'll start to notice a decrease in their seizure frequency after several months.
And so you mentioned children, but this can be used in adults as well.
Definitely, definitely. So it just starts off in children and always goes all the way up to adults.
Hi, this is Brandon from Citizens United for Research in Epilepsy, or CURE. Do you want to know about new discoveries in epilepsy research? Read the latest research insights at cureepilepsy.org. Now back to this episode of Seizing Life.
Have there been any research studies? Are there certain types of seizures that it does a better job of controlling, or is it just sort of a blanket treatment for all seizures?
So a blanket treatment for most seizures. Oftentimes we'll use it for focal seizures as well as generalized seizures. The focal seizures, sometimes we try to use the actual resective surgery, you know, the actual invasive brain surgery to try to remove that defective area of brain to try to see if that truly can be the cure for that person's epilepsy.
And so you mentioned that it is FDA approved for patients 4 years and older. Has it been used in younger patients?
It's definitely been used in younger patients. So kids that happen to have, you know, very intractable epilepsy, we do try to put the generator in. Oftentimes it's sort of dependent upon their size as well as the amount of subcutaneous tissue that they have in the area in which the generator would sit.
And what does that tissue mean?
The tissue that happens to be right below the skin. So they need to be sort of, you know, fat enough.
Okay.
To where we can find a pocket.
So those chunky babies.
Yes.
Those ones.
Yeah,
those
cute.
Chunky. Yeah.
Those are the ones
we like. It works well with those. And you brought a couple with you today. And apologies for those listening in that you're not able to see these, but I would say one is the size of, like, slightly bigger than a silver dollar.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know,
maybe thick as two or three.
And so would this one be, I mean, because I can't imagine something this large being placed in my daughter. She's 3 years old, and I mean, it would just, you know, take up such a large portion. So you did bring a smaller version, which is more of an oval shape, probably about half the size of the other one, but the same thickness. So would this be more of a pediatric size version?
So both of them happen to be pediatric size. This happens to be the older model. The smaller one happens to be the newer model.
Okay.
They have different features that make them sort of different. But now, for the most part, because the newer model happens to be smaller and has many more free features, that's the model that will be in most kids moving forward, or people moving forward.
Got it. And what are the difference? What are the different features that make them different?
Right. So we have Aspire, which is the model 106. So the model 106 has the ability to have heart track monitoring. So as you know, whenever many kids have, or people have, seizures, sometimes their heart rate goes up.
Yeah, that happens with my daughter.
Right. And so what we end up doing is sort of calibrating the normal heart rate for the person, and then identifying the 40%, 30%, or 20% increase in their heart rate, and then this will automatically go off.
Oh.
So that's called the auto stim feature.
Wow, okay.
And so sometimes that'll sort of capture some of the seizures before they actually happen.
Okay.
And as soon as the heart rate goes up, it'll sort of send a treatment dose of energy.
Okay.
Thereby sort of stopping some of the seizures.
Okay.
It already have the regulated sort of routine amount that comes out every 5 minutes. And then you have the opportunity to swipe with your magnet that gives many of the caretakers a lot of autonomy to stop the seizures whenever they happen.
Okay. And that's amazing to think of, because as you were talking about this, you know, some people have auras, or mm-hmm. they can feel that seizure coming on, or the very beginning stages of it. And they can communicate that, assuming that they're verbal.
Yes.
But for children who seizures have made nonverbal, like my daughter, there's no way that she can tell me that she feels something coming on. But we have her constantly connected to a pulse oximeter, mm-hmm. which monitors her heart rate. So we can kind of look at that, and we see as her heart rate starts to go up, everyone kind of goes on alert to keep an eye out for when that seizure is going to happen. And that would be a time where we could swipe.
Right. Or it would capture it itself, and you wouldn't actually have to do anything.
Great.
And so you can just change the percentage of the heart rate, where it's 40% increase, 20, or 10% increase, and then it would automatically give that extra delivery of energy at that time.
Okay. What are some of the other really cool things? I had no idea that they had all of these other cool features. What else should we know about them?
So the Centiva, which happens to be the more recent one, happens to have AM and PM dosing. And so sometimes kids will have more seizures during the day, and sometimes they'll have more seizures whenever they're sleeping in at night. And so it allows you to give a different dose of energy during the AM hours versus the PM hours, depending on when the frequency of their seizures may be. Sometimes you have something called frontal lobe nocturnal epilepsy. So it happens mm-hmm. nocturnally at night. And so then you can give additional doses of energy at night. This is obviously during the time in which they're less active. Some of the side effects, like hoarseness and cough, obviously will not be as bothersome to them because they're sleeping.
Mm-hmm.
And then the Centiva new model also has the ability to sort of detect if their patient is prone whenever they're happening to, you know, be sleeping. And as you know, sometimes the prone position is oftentimes the cause of SUDEP,
mm-hmm.
So sudden unexplained death in epilepsy patients. And it sort of gives us a general idea when they happen to be prone,
mm-hmm.
and then that can sort of turn into a way in which we can prevent the death of these epilepsy patients.
Amazing. So you talk about these different settings. How do you adjust these settings if it's inside the body? I mean, I'm looking at these, they're smooth. There's no like buttons or dials on these, obviously. So how are you adjusting?
So just like somebody that may have a pacemaker, you can sort of feel the pacemaker. You can feel these just below the skin. And there's a wand that we use, and a wand sort of activates the generator.
Okay.
And there we can make setting changes. So nothing that you feel, it's not any sort of piercings or any type of punctures to the skin. We just sort of put it over the device itself.
So what have you seen as the success rate for using this? You know, I imagine that it sort of varies, but, you know, have people achieved seizure freedom using the VNS? And are there some people that it just doesn't work for at all? What, you know, What can someone expect going into this?
So you can expect a reduction in your seizures with the VNS. You can expect that that reduction may happen, you know, six months, a year, 2 years down the line. So as you're sort of with the device in longer periods of time, you start to see a continued improvement in the reduction of your seizures. Furthermore, as your seizures sort of are reduced, you'll find that you'll be able to sometimes reduce your oral medications. And even further than that, oftentimes it gives you a lot more independence. Just because you, as the patient that happens to have epilepsy, you sort of know that you not only have the generator sort of giving you that jolt of energy every 5 minutes, but you also have the auto detection. And then for other caretakers that are around you, they have the autonomy to actually stop the seizure if you happen to have one.
But you have to be patient. I mean, because you're talking, you know, 6 months to 2 years once it's placed for you to see that difference in seizure activity. That can be a long time to wait to see a difference. It's interesting to me that, do they know why that is? Why it can take so long to see that that reduction in seizures?
So the thought process is mainly built on the fact that you're sort of changing the energy level and you're sort of trying to auto-modulate the brain waves in a way in which the now new jolts of energy sort of reduces the abnormal amount of energy that causes these seizures.
Okay. So at what point over the course of a patient's treatment plan would you sit down with them and recommend this piece of equipment?
So oftentimes I'll recommend it for kids that are having very long seizures, seizures that happen to be much more clinical, and seizures that happen to be intractable, meaning they've already tried two or more medications and still are having very frequent seizures.
Has anyone found a difference in the efficacy for the cause of the person's seizures? For example, whether it is a genetic cause, whether it is a brain malformation, or it is post-traumatic cause of the epilepsy?
No, it doesn't really fully matter. You know, the true cause of their epilepsy, it could be genetic, it could be post-traumatic, it could be due to a brain malformation. The main thing is just trying to get an additional jolt of energy, like I say, through the vagus nerve, to try to see if they can combat the seizures that may be happening.
It really seems to me that this device can help such a large swath of the epilepsy population. Why is it not used more frequently?
So I think it's sort of personality of the patient and personality of the caretakers. Sometimes they don't want to go through a surgery and prefer to continue with medication. Sometimes the actual placement of the device may be too much for their body habitus, and they may not have enough fat tissue to sort of stick it there.
Okay.
And then if the if there's a little bit of hesitation there, then we sort of wait and sort of reintroduce it a little bit later.
Dr. Hurd, thank you so much for coming and chatting with us and teaching us all things VNS. I know I learned so much today about this device, and I thought I knew I was pretty educated on it. So we really do appreciate that. And as always, I love to take a moment just to thank all of our pediatric epileptologists out there. We love what you do and keep doing it.
Thank you. I appreciate being here.
Thank you again, Dr. Hurd, for explaining more about how the VNS works. This leading-edge device is a great tool helping many patients in the fight against epilepsy. Unfortunately, VNS does not work on everyone, which is why we need more than one approach to help treat epilepsy. To help with that mission, we ask you to donate to CURE to fund more patient-focused research. Visit seizinglife.org/donate. No gift is too small. We appreciate your generosity.